you are. I mean, you are Matt Leacock.
This is so important to me.
without you, we wouldn't have some of the best known cooperative games out there. That is just. But would humans out there agree with me?
Yes.
Now, the two questions I have is, firstly, this is for housekeeping purposes. A, how do you get into it? And most importantly, how do you get into cooperative games rather than competitive games?
Yes. Yeah.
Talk to us.
Okay. Well, I've been designing games since I was a kid, and I played a lot of roll and move type games when I was a child, and I would get them. My parents knew I was into board games, and I would get these mass market games like the Scooby Doo board game or what have you. And I was perpetually disappointed with them, and so I flipped the game board over and just designed my own game on the back. And this continued until I was a teenager, when I was in high school and college. And I went for a graphic design degree, and my prototype started to look better because I knew graphic design. But really, the games were just terrible. I did a lot of really, really terrible games, and tried to crack into gaming for quite some time. You know, I brought a game to Essen in 2000, and just handmade 200 copies and sold those. And financially, it was a disaster, but I met really, really wonderful people there, and started making connections. Uh-huh. And so gradually, I kind of worked my way in, and just kept at it until about 2007, when I pitched Pandemic to Zeman.
And Seb said...
No, Seb said, I'm late for my plane, I'm going to take a look at it. I'm like, no, you know, I got 10 minutes with him at the Gathering of Friends in Ohio, and I'm just kind of getting pitched, and he took it away from me.
So why cooperative games? Because kind of a niche market. I mean, they are popular today, but when you started, they weren't really.
Yeah, you know, I actually looked it up because, cooperative games have actually been on for a long time. Jim, I think it's, what's it, Deep? I had to write this down because I can't remember his name ever.
Deepcode?
He's been doing, like, kids' games since 1971. So, like, over 40 years of cooperative games, hundreds of titles coming out of Canada. But they've been, like, kids' affairs, and I always kind of dismissed them as such. It was only when I played Kinesia's Lord of the Rings in 2000. And it's a gripping game. There was high stakes, this is a game of like, this is a game as a hobbit you can actually sacrifice your life for your friends. You know, I mean, there was some deep emotion in there. And it really opened my eyes to what would be possible in the cooperative game. I didn't think that kind of engagement was possible with cardboard. You know, you're fighting against this cardboard algorithm, and that really opened my eyes. So that's why I got interested in it. And a few years later, I started to dabble in it.
How easy was it for you, as a gamer who created and played an awful lot of role and move games, to actually shift from the player is my enemy to the game is my enemy? How did you go into that frame of mind?
I knew I needed a model and enemy, right? And diseases seem like a natural fit. I mean, they're unfeeling, uncaring, they kind of operate kind of like a computer algorithm themselves, you know. I was really into immersion effects, you know, very simple rules that could, I really wanted something to spiral out of control and have chain reactions and things like that. So I stumbled into the mechanism, you know, the part where you take the discard pile, shuffle it, put it on top. That was just me just fooling around and just playing and wondering what would happen if I did this or that.
At the same time, I mean, I don't know if you guys have had this experience, but when playing Pandemic, you begin to play Pandemic, and we win the game, played it easy, and then you go difficult, and the game pits you to the ground. I mean, it makes a pulp of my group every time. And yet, every time we want to get back to it again and destroy that. Is that something that you knew was going to happen? That people were going to be, that this frustration was actually going to be a catalyst for people to come back to it and actually a motivator at the end of it? Did it become a surprise to you?
It's kind of hard to say in hindsight. I mean, now I can kind of explain what's going on. You really want to keep people in a nice channel between boredom, where things are too easy, and anxiety, where they're just totally overwhelmed and can't handle it and walk away, flip the board. And so as long as you can kind of keep them in that channel, they're always going to be reaching for the next rung. And that's why it's important that, you don't play the first game and you win and then you go like, okay, well, that's done. You pack it up and put it on the shelf. You don't play it again. Like, you need to keep reaching. And so that's why the initial game, the intro game is challenging. And, it's important, once you master that, to have the next run of the game.
Is this something that, obviously I'm asking you about it, but is this something that people, when you do seminars about the game design itself, that people find hard to do, to find that balance between the healthy frustration and the flipping the table? Because it's a very thin line, and once it's crossed, it's very difficult to come back to the game again, so it's quite a risky move to do, actually.
Yeah, it is, and it just requires a tremendous amount of playtesting. There's some of the rules that were introduced late where the card comes out of the bottom of the pile, and you affect that with three cubes and put it on top. And that's designed so that there's always a sense of peril, right? Because at any time you can get an epidemic card, and if there's an epidemic card, at any time one city could outbreak. So that's engineered in order to keep you, anxious.
And since you began to do this cooperative games, in general, because I can imagine that you keep up with what the cooperative designers are doing, what do you think has changed? What's the difference between cooperative games designed when you started and cooperative designers now, maybe 10 years down the line? What's different?
I see some people, designers trying to attack certain problems. Some people talk about, how can we give each player more autonomy or have them cooperate independently toward their own goals, then have to cooperate but sort of have different goals. People innovating in that space where each player has got different information and different ways to make each player feel special. So it's not all a group think where you don't have one player kind of dictating everything. Some folks innovating in that space. I myself am really interested in the story. I think cooperative games have a really unique opportunity to unveil story over time, like a plot line or an arc. There's similarities with some computer games where you see cutscenes and you play the game and you have another cutscene, etc., and you keep moving forward. I think we'll probably see some interesting things in co-op games in that space as well.
Are we going to see some interesting things in co-op games within the announcement that we're going to be doing?
Well, that remains to be
seen. Okay, we're going to see. The other question that I have that really interests me an awful lot is how do you plan expansions within the core cooperative ethos of a game that you may have already done? Because there is a fine line to be crossed between expansion being a perpetuating the money-making machine, the business, of bringing people back to the game, get people coming, and actually staying true to the game, because otherwise people are going to be able to do so much. How do you approach expansions?
Yeah, it's changed over time. So, when I originally designed Pandemic, I didn't design it with expansions in mind at all. But there's a lot of demand for more variety. People play, I had no idea people would play 100, 200 times. I mean, that just blew me away. I haven't played it 200 times. now I have, without playtesting. But I'm like, oh my gosh. So, there's a lot of demand for it, and I just went back, and I actually collaborated quite a bit with Tom Lehman. And that was a really wonderful collaboration. We just brought in all sorts of ideas and worked them through and just picked the cream of the crop and put them in on the brink. And we cut out a bunch of stuff, and that went into in the lab, and we cut out some of that, and so there may be some more stuff coming along. But again, the base game, I think that the critical thing is that the base game is got a fairly straightforward engine with some seams, I guess, that you can kind of extend. You can add to it in a pretty reliable way. So you can add additional roles, you can add additional events, you can add different challenges. You can kind of contrast it with Forbidden Island, which is a very, very tight design, designed to be very accessible for kids. And I think it'd be a lot harder to expand on that game because it's so tight and so tightly balanced. So the answer there was to come up with a sequel, and it's been fun kind of rolling those out like a serial, like an adventure serial. The adventures go on this they go to the island, and then they go to the desert, who knows where they're going to go next. Keep you hanging, they've taken off in an airship, and where's that ship going to go to next?
I'm really gagging to make some announcements. I'm desperate to do this announcement. So I'm going to call on my beautiful assistant, Chris Birch. Please give a round of applause.
How are we going to do this? Well, I guess we've got a big banner to show you, which is probably the easiest way of doing it.
And do you want to play that for us?
Same time. This is live conferencing for you. This is what happens. That's your ring song, isn't it?
Penelope. Last summer we started talking to ITV, and I remember drawing Thunderbirds 2 as a kid in kindergarten. It was that special. And I knew it, you know, the whole potential of Thunderbirds, that it was a co-op game. I love Pandemic, I've been playing that step. And of course, when we started thinking about it, who else to design the ultimate co-op game than Matt? And so we met up at Essen and pitched him the idea. And Matt went off and watched lots of Thunderbirds. And got the idea. And so we've been talking about for the last few months. And it takes about sort of six months to get all the contracts done with ITV, but they're very excited. They actually were down here yesterday, seeing what we're actually up to. And so the whole process of selling them the idea of this isn't just a sort of little moving track and we'll put a few Thunderbirds pictures on, but it's a whole really unique, special game. It's for me, I think it's the ultimate geek dad game. I mean, probably a lot of you probably introduced Thunderbirds to your kids, your dad, brothers introduce you to Thunderbirds, and it's something that I think, you know, goes down through the generations. And our hope is to create something that is really much that sort of crossover game that, you know, you'll be able to play with your kids. You'll be able to, you know, just as a great game. It's going to be, you know, obviously with Matt's touch to it, it's going to be fantastic co-op danger game. And Matt will tell you a little bit more about what he's been doing.
Yeah, well, I can say that I dive into or dove into Thunderbirds. You know, being in the States, I wasn't immersed in it, so I watched a ton of it. And a few things immediately became apparent that it would have been a show that I would have loved as a kid. And then the opportunity to do a co-op game for the license seemed like the natural fit. Just because, I mean, this is a team all working together with a lot of peril involved. Also, just the ability to kind of reach new markets. For parents who are just seeing games to their kids, it seemed like a real natural fit. Plus seeing a Thunderbird 2 would be cool.
Yeah. That was the best one. So we're aiming for September next year is the tentative launch date, because it's the 50th anniversary of Thunderbirds, if you didn't know, next year. So lots of big events going on. There's a new TV series coming. I think it's just live action and animation mix, but we're basing it on the original, the real Thunderbirds. Nothing else exists. So that's our story. So I mean, I don't know if you want to come to the stand afterwards and.
I've got to go to quotes from.
Okay, yes, yeah, but I mean, I'll be around on the stand if you want to come and ask questions. We'll answer as much as we can. So, all right.
So meanwhile, I'm quite curious exactly when you were watching, because I'm a foreigner as well. I didn't watch Thunderbirds. I think I watched twice when I was a child. I'm sorry about that. And I thought it was absolutely hilarious. Seriously, it's quite fun. When you watched it, what is the first thing that caught your eye that you thought, what could be a thing here?
You know, I don't know if it was the gaming that really caught me so much as the fact that it's like, wow, these are handmade. You can see how the game is made. And I feel like it's almost like a, you know, you see the miniatures. And it's like this hobby experience that you're watching on Fast Forward.
What is it that you like the most about the series itself?
Well, I mean, I like that. I read a lot about the creator's intentions behind it, and I really thought they're laudable. He didn't want to bring geopolitics in it. He just wanted to present a good, positive experience to kids, and he didn't play down to them. He didn't dumb stuff down. And so you're watching it, and you can tell that he's written it for both adults and kids, and he's not pandering. Mm-hmm. And I think so many board games pander, mm-hmm. and they're not challenging them. You know, I've had two daughters of my own, and you know, they like a good challenge. I mean, that leads to a good game, and likewise with that series, I think you watch it, and the kids are being spoken to, or they're given some adventures that don't speak down to them. I hope to do a game that offered a similar experience.
I'm going to be cautious with the questions I'm going to ask you about the game, because okay. I can imagine that there will be some things that either you cannot talk about just yet, or it's too early to talk about, but what can you tell us in terms of what the game is going to be about?
Well, there will probably be some global disasters.
Okay.
The Thunderbirds might appear.
We know the Thunderbirds will be there. We know it's going to be a cooperative game.
Yeah.
How many players do you have in mind?
I don't have a hard number for that. I want to make sure there's a variable number of players. Mm-hmm. I'll be damn sure Lady Penelope is
yes.
In the game.
That's great. How big in scope have you thought of this game in terms of where would you like the production to go?
Well, I'd love to be able to see some sculpts, and I think we'll be talking about production of those things so that you can actually, you know, enjoy the miniatures for the models mm-hmm. to some extent. And I'd love the players to feel like they're taking on the role of part of that crack team to see if they could pilot one of these things. Mm-hmm. I think it's really about kind of taking on the role of one of the team. And, you know, trying to do what they do on the screen.
How far advanced are the rule sets? Ready, 80%, 90%, 50%?
You know, I always talk about the first 80% and the second 80%.
Okay.
I'm approaching the first 80%. Yeah.
And what's been the most challenging in terms of working with the franchise? I mean, how I'm not sure if you work with franchises before of this level and this height. But what's been so far the most challenging thing about doing something for the Thunderbirds?
Really, I haven't had any challenges yet. So okay. Yeah, stay tuned. Things have been coming.
You're making waves when you see.
I mean, I think we agreed on a common vision early on. So, you know, once you've got that goal aligned, mm-hmm. it's a pretty straightforward kind of head toward it.
So, I mean, it sounds like you're really chill about the whole thing. No, it's going to be no worries. This is all fine. Are you envisaging this project to be different than any projects that you've worked with in the past, in the sense of the way that you approach it and the way that you are going to think about it?
Well, every project's been different. I've worked with three or four different publishers independently, so I like to think of myself as pretty adaptable. Some of the greater challenges are just, you know, finding enough time to do lots of really great playtesting under deadlines. So I want to make sure that I can carve enough time to make sure this thing's really tuned up and ready to go. So I want to deliver a quality product.
Okay. So I'm going to throw a fairly difficult question now. Mm-hmm. Apart from the fact that it is Thunderbird and that is going to be awesome in itself, what do you think is going to be the best aspect of this game will have to offer to the players? Mm.
Yeah, that's interesting. So, I mean, a lot of it is just forming and gelling right now. So, what is that critical core component? I don't want to boil it down into mechanisms, you know, because that's just not a really interesting way to talk about things. You know, when you read an advertisement, it gives you a checklist of all of
them. No, but when people finish playing the first game they play of Thunderbird, what do you want them to come out with?
Well, I mean, generally speaking, it's a feeling of relief. Yeah. Oh my god, we actually made it. Yeah.
So the a sense of satisfaction.
Sure. Yeah, I mean, generally speaking, when I'm designing these things, it's really about trying to create a challenge mm-hmm. that's not too hard, not too easy. And then the real key to having an engaging experience is to modulate their emotions. Yeah. So, you know, give them this wonderful sense of hope in the beginning, and then crush it. And you have to repeat that throughout the course of the game. So, things are really good. Oh, that's going to be a problem. Oh, things are really good. That's a problem. And if you can kind of keep that kind of engagement throughout the course of the game and escalate it over the course of the game, and generally speaking, have a good... It's like storytelling, right? You don't want a movie that's just sort of like flat, right? You want to have ups and downs and a climax. And
you really are thinking very hard about this game, aren't
you? Oh, yeah! Yeah.
Okay, I would like to open the floor for questions. So you should have quite a lot of questions, so hands up.
Hi, Matt. With the Thunderbird franchise and the fact that you're working with ITB, do you think this is a game that might be a strong sort of gateway to bring more people into the hobby and show that gaming is a new and modern thing? Because the Thunderbirds, like say, will get the dads and mums into buying it. Do you think it's going to be able to be a mass market game that can transfer people into proper games?
Yeah, that's very much my hope. Right. I mean, I love to design games that are gateways. Forbidden Isle is very much that way. Just trying to get try to reach out to the mass market and show people that games don't have to be rolling with affairs or from the 1930s. Right? That my biggest hope there is to attract new audiences, and I think this is a great way to do it.
Next question. The young lad over there, I'll be the hand up.
Yeah, hi Matt. I still have a Tracy Island at my mum's house and lots of toys, and I'd love a reason to get them out again. So will they be compatible with the new game?
So the space is on the game, you can be
okay,
I'll
do that.
I'll do my best.
Thank you.
Hello. Given that you have trained as a graphic designer and that you are interested in the storytelling, mm-hmm. how much important is it for you the look of the game? And do you have any input into the different editions? Mm-hmm. Is there any favorite edition of Pandemic?
I am a trained graphic designer, but I've been just delighted to be able to hand off the final production work to the publishing houses, who have blown me away in many cases with the production. I'm like, when I saw the first copy for Forbidden Isle, I'm like, oh my god. And then they told me the price point, I'm like, you're kidding me, because the game is pretty reasonable for what you get in it. So it's been great to be able to kind of bring things up to a prototype level of quality, hand them off. And then I generally get a sign-off or at least a lot of input on the way I think the design is going. And often I'm looking for accessibility issues, can you read the type? Does the design of the iconography make any sense? Is it going to get in the way of play, first and foremost? But then I'm also looking at the theme. Here we have a really rich theme. So, the graphic design is makes itself in many cases, and it's not hard to imagine. Even when I'm holding a card and it's only got a word on it, to know what that card will look like. So, I hope to have some input, but I think a lot of it's already, and there's so much inventory for Thunderbirds already, I think it shouldn't be too much of an issue.
Next question. You are there with the T-shirt.
Hi, I'm ashamed to say I haven't had a chance to play Pandemic yet, but I have played Forbidden Isle, and so don't shout. But just when you designed it, talking about the aesthetic of it, it's a beautiful game. Where did the ideas originally come from? Because obviously it's so different from, it is and it's not different from Pandemic from what I've heard about the game. But the aesthetic and the whole sort of play structure, where did the idea come from?
For which one? For
Forbidden Island.
So I was approached by a gamer, and they asked if I could design a game that kind of bottled up a lot of the cooperative magic of Pandemic in an accessible game for kids, because they do a lot of kids' card games. And so originally it was a card game, and the theme was you're on a spaceship and it was being hit by asteroids, and you had to run around your spaceship and collect your helmet, or your spacesuit, your alien artifact, and your flight plan, one other thing. So your four things, right? That's where it came from, and your spaceship was being hit by asteroids and parts were flying off instead of sinking, right? And you had to run and repair them. The engine of the game worked really great, but they didn't want a space theme, so we worked on more themes, and I tried that. You were tunneling underground, you were doing port treasures there, it was caving in. And then we worked on the island theme, and that one really seemed to fit the best.
That's not a kid's game. The first time I played it, me and my friend just nearly threw it at the wall. We played it on hard mode the first time.
Oh,
hard
mode. That's your...
Right, there was another question over there, sir.
Yeah, hi Matt. I was wondering, when you're trying to balance the challenge of a game, how much maths is in that versus kind of trial and error and just testing and testing and testing?
It's mostly China.
Right.
Yeah, because there's such a human component to it, and there's so many variables that if I try to model it out. It's fun to see people create computer models after the game's out. Someone did a 4,000, they took the play data from, I think, over 4,000 runs of Roll Through the Ages, which I had done, and statistically calculated like the best developments. And I was just thinking, oh, if I had that when I was designing the game, it would have been amazing. But no, I don't do a lot of computer models.
Next question.
Okay.
Go ahead. Sorry, go ahead.
Yeah, so I'm curious. It's taken until the 21st century for cooperative gaming to hit critical mass and become popular. And yet, in hindsight, you can look at it and play these games and go, wow, that is so obvious. How come it took till the 21st century for us to make this happen and make it become popular? What were we missing in the 20th century?
Yeah, that's a really interesting question. For me, it was like the, I don't know, I mean, it's difficult to come up with a system that can respond to players with just cardboard and paper. And I think some of the design patterns have just kind of emerged out of all the tinkering. I mean, there's a much bigger audience now than there was, and I think there's just a lot more experimentation. And it requires a lot of fearless experimentation. But you could say the same thing about deck building, right? We haven't had deck builders for so long, or worker placement, or trivia games when doing Pursuit Kingdom.
But in hindsight, it seems obvious.
Yeah. Well, I wonder what will happen, you know, in the next 10 years, what the next development will be. I'm not sure what really tipped co-op games, but they really have been growing. It's remarkable. I looked at the Board Game Geek database. I actually had to ask them to change their search page results so I could count the number of co-op games that were produced. It's about 10% of the new titles that were introduced in 2013 have a cooperative play element. And that's up from 3% for the last 40 years, from 79 forward. It was just 3% all the way, and just hockey stick up after about 2009.
Do you think it could be the paradigm of games themselves is actually changing? That before, games were perceived as something you play against each other, and finally, as a society, society of gamers, we actually begin to realize that, you know what, we don't really need to play against and have a good time, we can play with and have a
good
time.
Yeah, it's a good question if it's more of a reflection of society, or if it's the designer, or maybe it's that, society is more open to it. There's this article with Jim from Family Pastimes talking about his co-op games, and the questions he always gets, like, well, how can it be a game if there's no competition? You know, it's like a mindset that, in order for it to be interesting, there must be competition. And I think as a game designer, it's difficult to kind of come up with that unless your eyes are open, but there's some good examples.
I'm just not playing Monopoly.
Sorry, I've got another question. It's only two questions, really. So when you play Pandemic, what's your strategy?
Really? I'm not going to say that I can. Too much of the game for me. I mean, I never put player aids in the back of the game because it's spoiling all the fun, right? So I'll have to do that as a mystery. Maybe you can catch me on the way. You grill me. I'll tip on you.
There was another question.
Another question is, what are your views on purely cooperative versus semi-cooperative with traitors and stuff like that?
I think they're all interesting. For myself, I like doing the pure co-ops. I'm not exactly sure why. I think I like the energy it engenders. You know, I designed Pandemic to play with my wife, so at the end of the game, we both feel really good. You know, I wouldn't hate her, she wouldn't hate me. And when you got a traitor, you know, I think it's a fascinating social exercise. It's just not one that I'm as attracted to as a designer. But I played Battlestar Galactica and I've been a Cylon, and it was really exciting, so I totally get it. Yeah, I don't really have a strong preference for playing one versus the other. I just like the pure co-op.
Yeah, go
ahead.
I was just wondering what your favorite games are at the moment.
We play Trains to Death. I like deck builders like the next person, I guess. Some of the classic games, I like ENT, Tigers and Freddy's, I play a lot of that. ENT's games, so I think the world of his stuff.
Yeah.
which is so elegant, elegantly designed. Yeah, we end up playing new games every other week, so there's a lot of them.
Sorry, I've got another one. You mentioned earlier that there's a design space for designers to be concerned about dominant players.
Mm-hmm.
How concerned are you about dominant players, and is it something you thought about with Thunderbirds?
I think about it with every game. I think there are certain design patterns you can use to help mitigate it a little bit. Try to look at the pandemic that your hand is secret, which kind of works, kind of doesn't. It makes the game a little bit less accessible to new players. Wherever I can, I try to reduce it a bit, but I think to some extent it's just a natural part of the play style. I designed a game to play with family and friends. I understand that if you play Pickup Pandemic and you just do a pickup game at a convention, you might be running into people whom you don't know very well, and they might have very dominant personalities. And there's really not a whole lot I can do about that. It's I'm setting a table, right, a medium for people's personalities to come through. And some people are just more dominant than others. There's certain things I can do to mitigate it, but I don't think I can solve that problem. In the same way, I do a lot of software design, communication software design for teams to communicate. And I can engineer it in all sorts of turn-taking and safeties and checks, but at the end of the day, I'm just kind of a rule that, just to provide some sort of accountability so that people behave well, good reasons for people to behave well rather than too much heavy-handed rules to mitigate it, if that makes sense.
Next person?
So some of your games have been converted to electronic format. I wonder what you thought about that, whether somebody's introduced to playing on an iPad, you can be happy, or do you think it's a more pure experience to play on a tabletop?
That's a great question. I'm glad you asked that. I love it when they're on iPad. I think it's fantastic, and I'd love to get it on the iPhone. I think Xenia's working on that right now. And I think it's important, because the single biggest barrier to playing any game is learning how it's played. And, there's no two ways about it. It's work. You have to read the rules, and you have to teach the rules to an audience that you're hoping is patient with you, because it's difficult. You have to learn all this stuff. So if you pick up the iPad version, first of all, you've got a lower price point, but you've got a guided experience. You've got basically this expert player, the computer algorithm, teaching you how to play the game. And it's a safe environment. You're by yourself. You can learn it. And then you're empowered to teach it to other people and not feel like you're a fool, that you're wasting their time. I mean, you're asking someone to carve out part of their evening, right, to play a game with you. And if you bore them to tears, then you're kind of losing their trust, and they don't want to hang out with you anymore. So it's, kind of asking a lot of people. So I think it's really great. You get a lower price point, you learn how to play the game, and then you go out and buy the physical edition and play it with people across the table and actually interact with them and do all the great things that board games give us.
Next question.
Okay, go ahead. Normally, we play as tools, which can be a problem with some games, but thankfully not yours. Do you sort of build in a factor for difficulty from two players, or how does that work?
Yeah, I was really surprised when I designed Pandemic that it scaled fairly well from 2 to 4, and then with the expansions up to 5, just given the way the infection round comes in. So you have a player beat, and then sort of like an evil beat, and then a player beat, and an evil beat. And so if you add additional players to that rhythm, it doesn't seem to disrupt too many things. With On the Brink, we corrected a little bit for the number of players, so you get more events or fewer events just to mitigate that somewhat, because cards are dispersed amongst other players. So I try to be attuned to that. Forbidden Desert was a real pain to try to balance. It's a little bit more difficult with more players. So just keep that in mind. Maybe you'll address the difficulty accordingly. And we play test on all the different difficulty settings just to make sure that the game will support and make adjustments accordingly.
There's another question behind the back
there. Yeah, hi again, Matt. Board games are a relatively new hobby for me. My original love was video games when I was a kid, and what I loved about video games was all of my friends coming over and us all being in the same room and shouting tips to each other and doing things. And as technology moved on, they stopped coming over because they say, we'll just play over the internet, there's no need to get in the same house anymore. And it sort of lost the fun for me. The fun was being together. And so I moved on to board games, and a few of my friends would come over and play, but there was lots of rules to learn, and some people said, you're going to beat me because I've never played before, and that sort of thing.
Mm-hmm.
when pandemic came out, all of a sudden it was really easy to get people to play. It's like, no, we're working together. We're on the same team. And it was a real catalyst, because then all my family would play, all my friends would play. And it really brought back all those memories from a child of being with my friends and family doing stuff. So this isn't really a question, more just to say thanks, Matt. Because thank you.
Appreciate that.
First of all, thanks. I play Forbidden Island with my young children and they love it. Is it cooperative? I'm not sure, because whilst my daughter is squealing and busy shoring up, my son is holding back because he's a diver and he just can't wait to leap in. we see it, but thank you for that. But a question. In designing games, have you ever had the equivalent of writer's block with some aspect? And if so, how did you come in? Any stories there? And secondly, have you ever gone quite far in a game design and then had to shelve it because you realised then that it wasn't going to work? So, two things.
It's difficult to actually kind of separate the two. I've got a game called Ants, tentatively called Ants. I've been working on it longer than Pandemic. And I've shelved it, I think, on no fewer than six different occasions. I'll get some spark of inspiration, I'll pull it down, work on it a bit. And it's just not going anywhere, so it goes back up on the shelf. That's why it's important for me. I try to do, it's difficult to say whether I do a theme first or a core mechanism first. Often they kind of come together. Because if I just have a theme, like I did with Ants, I did a tremendous amount of research on the way ant colonies work, on mutations, and all those sorts of things. But the design just kind of meandered freely. So yeah, I do end up with a block and get frustrated and have to put it on the shelf. And I'd much rather do that than come out with a derivative pile of, steaming mechanisms.
We haven't had really any questions from this side of the audience, so I'm going to... Yeah, you're the only brave one here, so come on, people, bring it up. Yes.
So, were you involved in Pandemic the Cure? And what is it?
Oh, yeah, I'm glad you brought that up. So Pandemic the Cure is going to be coming out in October. It's a fast-playing version of Pandemic. It's a dice game, and I was playing a tournament last Friday. So it's like all the tension of Pandemic all kind of bottled up in a smaller package. So you can actually set the game up in about 1 minute and play it in about 30. And I've got a copy in the library if any of you guys want to check it out. I was heavily involved in that game. I designed it. I've been tuning it for almost 3 years. Because we slated it in production schedule and actually time to really tune the heck out of it. So I'm really proud of the design. Should be coming out this fall, hopefully at Spiel.
Yeah, so some of the questions were there.
Yeah. You said you had influence over readability of cards, things like that. As we get to more of an international market, do you worry about designing symbols rather than words, or trying to make your game easily convertible into foreign language? How does that factor into your design very often?
Yeah, so when designing the components, I like most of the game to be in the components whenever possible when it aids play. Because then you don't have to refer to the rules as much. Now there's a trade-off there. You don't want your cards to be walls of text. And I also like the games to be learnable on multiple channels. So in many cases, if you have an icon, you can recognize it very quickly, but far faster than it would take you to read the copy of the text. But there are certain cases, like an epidemic card, for example, where it's step-by-step, and it's fairly complicated, so in testing, I put the rules just on the card, so you never have to refer to the rules, and you can follow it step by step. And there's a trade-off there between the ability to localize the game inexpensively and the ability to learn the game quickly, and again, not to do lookup. When I'm hard-pressed to make that call, I'll go with learnability and playability over time. But there are real production cost trade-offs that need to be made from time to time. Those do have a factor. So yeah, I'm always thinking about it, but my primary objective is to try to make the game easy to learn and easy to play.
We have time for one more question. Yes, gentlemen.
Do you ever get threats from the Hypochondriac Society?
No, occasionally I hear people who are turned off by the theme, but they're pretty rare. Did some things to make sure that they weren't too real world.
I do have a real question.
Yeah.
there were some rumors lately on Board Game Geek about a legacy variant of Pandemic. Is that true? Are you involved with that?
I can neither confirm nor deny. That's about all I can say about that.
So contractually, is that what you can say? Right, everybody, thank you very, very much for attending. Thank you, Molly.